Name, Steven Pastel. Band, The Pastels. Instruments played, electric guitar and sound. My band, The Pastels, formed in the black hole of the early 80s. We felt very outside the whole prevailing Glasgow 80s music thing, which just seemed hostile and kind of stupid, really. So, I guess we all felt pretty antagonistic towards it, and we started up our own things. I was asked to participate in a new label that was starting. It would be called 53rd and 3rd, which was David Keegan's idea because the Ramones were his favourite band and it was one of their songs. We put out records by the BMX Bandits, the Boy Hairdressers, which became Teenage Fan Club, the Vaseline's and Beat Happening. I guess people retaliated against us by saying that we were childish just because in many respects we were unsophisticated, and they related that with the childishness, which I don't think was the case. I think all our bands do have a naive quality, and I believe all good rock music or any good form of music must have a naivety about it, because it's so important that whenever you plug in your guitar, you believe that anything's possible.
The phenomenon has probably been going for 10 years. It began with Edwin Collins and Orange Juice Postcard, who sought to redefine Scottish rock in non-hairy-chested macho terms. Thereupon, Steven Pastel picked up the mantle. That would be 82-ish to about 84. And around about 84, there was a bit of an explosion. Pastel and Norman and Joe and Douglas have all just been, they've reassured one another about each other's taste in music, and it's provided a kind of a philosophical platform to them, for them all to go on to greater things.
Pastels, Vaseline's, BMX Bandits, Captain America, Eugenius.
Instruments played?
Guitar player and singer. Born in Calton, in the shadow of the Barrowland, and brought up in Parkhead, stayed there for about 20 years. Well, I met Steven Pastel in the Griffin Bar, the famous Griffin Bar, and got to know him, met people like Primo Scream. He kind of named us the Vaseline's, we thought it was pretty strange name. He had his record label, so we had our first record out on that label and became label mates with everybody. After the Vaseline split up, I didn't do anything for about a year and a half. Kind of worked in a pub in town, and I was kind of watching Teenage Fan Club playing in Glasgow, and I was really, really enjoying them. I just thought, this is stupid, why I should be in a band. It made me excited again and just wanted to start playing in a band again. So I really just phoned up a few people and we managed to get a show. And it was all kind of joke, really, but we got reviews from it and people started taking this really seriously. So it was quite strange. So basically, I thought, well, that was a bit of a scam, so I may as well keep it going. And formed a real band called Captain America. We put out two EPs. One of them was called Flame On. The artwork for the cover was basically the CNE logo, so the threatened legal action. And made us change the sleeve of the record. And then Marvel Comics, because they didn't like the idea that there was a band called Captain America. It's because of their superhero. And they threatened us with legal action to change the name. So we came up with a really, really great name of Eugenius, because when I was in the Pastels, they used to call me Eugenius, because I couldn't do anything. So I thought, it's gone from useless to genius. The genius takes over, or something like that.
Scene of bands that are somewhat really influenced by the Scottish underground for some weird reason, or there's like a shared kind of consciousness. The Pastels were a band that I remember hearing about like years ago when we were on a tour in the States, and these fanzine writers would ask us if we had ever heard of the Pastels. It's interesting because bands from Scotland were sort of more kind of hip to these fanzine writers than English bands. You know, it seemed like the kind of the music coming out of the underground in Glasgow was seemed to be a bit more distinctive in a way. I think it was Teenage Fan Club where a lot of people in America first started hearing like new music coming. What you do to me, I know, I can't believe. There's something about you got me down on my knees. The first album, which was called The Catholic Education, I think we got fairly good reviews here. I mean, things, you know, really started to happen for us in America because we sort of became hip in the sort of fanzine scene in America. A sort of big underground, sort of cool kid network or whatever, you know, and we sold quite a lot of albums there, and that sort of came back across the Atlantic. I think the highest chart position in this country that we've had with a single was, I think it was 31 or something, with a song called What You Do To Me, which, I think apparently we nearly had Top of the Pops, but they were showing the Michael Jackson video that night. So we get them next day. I know, I can't believe there's something about you got me down on my knees. At one point in this country, no major record labels were interested in us at all. It was sort of weird because, I mean, there was about 10 record companies in America wanted to sign us, and there was like a big sort of bidding war. It was really crazy. We played gig at Fairfax High School, which is Phil Spector's old school. The day we got there, it was like, I mean, we felt as though we were in the Beatles or something, you know, because on the radio all day, they did this sort of live radio broadcast from the gig, outside the gig, talking to lots of kids going to the show and stuff, and it was really, really exciting. It was good, you know.
Here they are, Nirvana!
I think the whole thing of Nirvana doing so many covers of Vaseline songs, I think perked up a lot of interest in what was going on in, you know, Scotland.
Supported Nirvana on the British tour. We got back, we finished, and we kind of got back to Glasgow, had a rest, and then started recording an album, and we'd given Nirvana some Captain America t-shirts to stay, go as a present, and then next thing Kurt's on in front of the NME wearing a t-shirt, and it's all of a sudden everybody wants to hear us and everybody wants to know about us. I never thought that this I'd be sitting here signed to Atlantic Records on the same label as people like Bette Midler and Ray Charles.
I think they just represent kind of like, you know, intelligent youth culture, you know, which is something to be aligned with.
In my period of a year, I visited Japan 4 times, two times with the BMX Bandits proper, and there was 2 other times I went out and had a Japanese backing group. The response we got of people, it was amazing.
Over there at the time when it happened, from like sitting in your bedroom in 1985 to being coast to coast in America on television in everybody's homes, it's quite an achievement. We're just 100% fans of music, and we wanted to like be a part of the history of music. And being successful wasn't a thing that fueled being in the band. Having our name known by like even 5 people is as fascinating as it could be for us. That's what we're all about.